let the child have the trouble to live in God, to live also in me. In my father's house, there are many mansions. If it were so, I would have told you, I want to prepare a place. Weeping may joy for the night, but joy comes in the morning. Bless those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Good evening, family and friends. We want to comment on service right away. We wish you God. From the person. Alright, how great. Alright, I trust the Lord of the Lord. And we wish you God. Oh Lord, my God.
time to you to understand the Lord. Continue for help, sir. Continue for all that you have done for me, what you are about to do in my life. God, we, your children, come out here tonight, this afternoon. You are going to remind me nothing. One who more given as we do, but take the state of action. Lord, you have.
Is missing. You know what part. I thank you, dear God, for Lord Heavenly Father, for him. I pray that you will build him at this present time, dear God, because Lord Heavenly Father, have thy own sweet way. Lord Heavenly Father, you did comfort Mary and Martha in time gone by. I pray that you comfort your manservant. Help him not to mourn as a man without a hope, dear God. Lord Heavenly Father, because one day we too will be in the same state, dear God. Lord, so I'm asking you, dear God, to build on him, dear God. Thank you for him. I pray, dear God, for even the brothers and the sisters and Lord Heavenly Father, nieces, nephews. I pray for all of them at this time. Lord, they will miss her. They love her, but Lord, you love her best. Lord, I'm asking you, dear God, to help them, dear God, to accept, Lord Heavenly Father, your doings. Because, Lord Heavenly Father, you is the one that created her. She belongs to you. And Lord, she is back home where she belongs. Because we are just travelers. We don't belong here. Lord, I thank you, dear God, for Lord, what is to be said and what is to be done today. Lord, it is not any good to the dead, dear God. It is for us who is, Lord Heavenly Father, left behind to take stock of our life. Lord Heavenly Father, where we can make our wrong right. Lord Heavenly Father, I'm asking you to have thy own sweet way. Teach us, Lord, your ways. Teach us to do the things that is right and pleasing in our sight. I pray, dear God, for the ministers, dear God, each and every one of them. Lord, whatever word is to come today, dear God, I pray that it comforts, it soothes. Lord, I pray that it brings some form of a consolation to the family. And Lord, Heavenly Father, bring a word, dear God, for Lord, those who know thee. And for those who does not know thee, Lord Heavenly Father, this, Lord Heavenly Father, I pray that it will be a means of their, Lord, coming to know you as their Lord and as their personal Savior. I thank you again for all that you have done. Thank you, dear God. I pray, dear God, that you, Lord, just have thy own sweet way. In no other name, but in Jesus' name, I pray this prayer. With thanksgiving in my heart, both now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
We join together as we share the Lord's Prayer. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley and the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. Family and friends, we are here today in the homegoing service for our beloved sister Jelissa. We thank God for the years that he had lent her to the family and to all those who were privileged to know her and to interact with her at different levels in life. We thank God this evening that we could continue to encourage ourselves, encourage one another, and even encourage the family this evening. On behalf of my own family, the church, we extend our condolences to the entire family, to our dad, Brother Elliott, and the other siblings this evening. And we pray that even as we join in this homegoing service, truly, my friends, we will continue to trust God, take God at His word, and know that you can find the healing, the comfort, and the strength that you need in the word of the Lord. And God had promised never to give us more than we can bear. But nevertheless, this evening, sometimes the load, the burden that we are bearing seems to be so unbearable. But there's a writer that says, do you sometimes feel forsaken when the load seems hard to bear? Talk it over with your master. You are really not alone. God is in it. And the mere fact that there are so many of you here today speaks to the family that we are here this evening to help support and help encourage you and help to share your burden this evening. I know it's a bit tough on behalf of the family, but nevertheless, God's grace is sufficient to keep you. Amen. All right, we join in our scripture reading as we continue this afternoon. Find me sharing from that very, very familiar passage that has brought comfort to so many hearts around the world, and it is still giving comfort even up till today. John 14, verses 1 through to 6. And these were the words of the Lord Jesus. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again to receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And whether I go, ye know, and the way, ye know. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whether thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. All right, so as we continue in our program this evening, we have a special by Maya and Janice. Did I pronounce the name right? Maya and Janice. Are you here? If you're not, well, then we call you later. All right, if they're not here, then we go on and we'll take them in a minute this evening. Stand with me and worship again. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, ta fortress of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God. Can be seated this evening. We have the eulogy. I don't have the name of the person that would be sharing it. If you are here this evening, can you identify yourself? All right, who is doing it? Not here, it seems. We shall have a grand time up in heaven. We shall have a time. Can I invite us to stand with me? Have a grand time. Walking with it. Singing hallelujah. We shall have. Oh, life on earth is so sweet. How will it be, my friends, on the other side? Are you hearing me? All we experience here, my friends, is only a foretaste of what we are hoping and what we believe we are going to be experiencing on the other side. The psalmist declares in Psalm 16, in the presence of the Lord there is fullness of joy, and at his right hand there are pleasures, my friends, forevermore. Our beloved sister says goodbye to us. She has left us, my friends, in the land of the living. As a matter of fact, there remains, my friends, a void in the hearts of many that were close with her, her close associate and even family. But may I say to us this evening, when nothing else can fill that void, I can assure us this evening that Jesus is able to stand in the gap. He is able to fill that joy. He is able to give that peace, my friend, that passes all understanding. She lived and she enjoyed her life from her perspective. And we give God thanks. Are you hearing me this afternoon? But we yet remain in the land of the living, that we can chart our course this evening and cry out like Saul on that Damascus road, Lord, who art thou and what will thou have me, my friends, to do? We are not here, my brothers and my sisters, by chance. We are not here by accident. We are not here because of somebody's mistake, my friend, but we are here because of the plan and the purpose of God. And whilst we are passing through, we all must bear in mind, it is only once we all are passing, my friends, this way. And there is another writer that says that life is the time to serve the Lord, my friend, and to ensure our great reward. So I pray this evening that as the family goes through, my friends, this time and this period of mourning, oh, may it be a time, my friend, of drawing them even closer and closer, my friend, to our Lord Jesus Christ. Trust him, my friend, even more than you had ever trusted him before. And peradventure, my friend, you would experience him in a more living and dynamic way than you had ever experienced him, hallelujah, before. God is good. God has a plan. God has a purpose. And let us remember, my friend, this evening, when all is said and done, we all got to stand before God to give an account. I pray this evening, this homegoing service for Jelissa, we will not take it lightly. We will not take it, my friends, even for granted. Because when we say goodbye and she's placed in the earth, life goes on for you and I. Are you hearing me this evening? How are we going to chart our course in this direction? May we be like the psalmist David. Teach us to number our days that we may apply our hearts to wisdom. Okay, I'm not sure if our sisters are ready to Maya, and is it Chinese? Are you here this evening? Then come share with us this evening. Clinton, feed the mic. The one on the side. Yeah.
A special good evening to everyone. I would like to dedicate this song to Jel.
I'm jealous of the rain that falls upon your skin. It's closer than my hands have been. Oh, I'm jealous of the rain. I'm jealous of the wind that ripples through your clothes. It's closer than my shadows. Oh, I'm jealous of the rain. 'Cause I wish you the best of all this world could give. And I told you there's nothing to forgive. It's hard for me to say I'm jealous of the way you're happy without me. I'm jealous of the rain that falls upon your skin.
Let me ask us to put our hands together again for that wonderful rendition. Thank you very much, our beloved sister. All right, let me give a minute for anyone who is in the company and you just want to do a couple seconds in reflection. All right? Or maybe you'd want to just say condolence to the family or something. Let me give you a minute or so to do it. If you are here and you so desire. All right, that tells me that many of us has things to say, but we just don't want to stand up this evening. Amen? All right, God bless you. All right, so I'm not sure if the person doing the eulogy would be here. If you're here at this time. If not, then we will have to continue. All right, so with us this evening is Pastor Piper and also Reverend Britton. He is no stranger to some of us and certainly not to the family this evening. I think I consider him a family member too. All right, so I want to ask him to share a little bit with us. I would reserve Pastor Piper. He shared with us last night at the prayer meeting. So I want to ask Reverend Britton to share with us whatever God would want to use him to say. And while he prepare himself to share, may we prepare our hearts to hear. Did you hear me this evening? As he prepare himself to share, may we prepare our hearts to hear. This is not a time for us to be concentrating on anything else, but hear what God would have to say to us. Maybe somebody is a bit troubled in mind and you're looking for answers, and probably in this service is where God would have an answer for you. Probably, my friends, you are at a crossroad in your life. You have good intention to do some things. You have the potential to do it, but you just don't have the power to make it a reality. But remember, hear what Paul says, I can do all things, but he said, through Christ that strengthened me. As if he appeared to come, we sing another and then. When I get there, oh, when I get there, I will sing a song. When I get there, hallelujah, praise ye God.
Pleasant good evening to each and everyone, or good afternoon. Greet you this afternoon in that most precious and wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Special good afternoon to the host pastor and to the bereaved family. Special good afternoon to you. How do we deal with situation like this? How do we deal with reality? It is before us. We see day after day, weeks after week. We see it a couple times for the month, a couple times for the year. How do we deal with this? We know we cannot leave it at home in our drawing room because it is going to smell. So we may keep it a couple days, but eventually we know that we have to take it down there and put it from whence it came. Amen? Amen. So we bless God this evening. The text was read before us, and I want to stay in the text. Jesus asks a question this evening, and he said, "Believest thou me? Do you believe what I am saying? Do you believe what I am telling you this evening?" What it is he was telling them, he said, "I am going to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you may be, if you believe." It is important that we believe, and we believe what God say. If you choose to believe what God say, or if you don't choose to believe what God say, the thing about it is that you can't change that. The wages of sin is death. This is the conclusion of sin. We can't change it. You may not believe it, but you can't change it. We could live our lives as if we don't care about it. We still can't change it. Somebody say, "Well, I don't believe that, and I don't believe this, and I don't believe them, and I don't believe she, and I don't believe he." It don't change the fact that the evidence we have here is dead. It is real. We all, as the Bible says, going to come to the point where we have to deal with death. And Jesus was giving them a promise. And he was saying that, "I am going to prepare a place." Now we know that the place that he was going to prepare, it was not on the earth. Because he was about to leave the earth to go back from whence he came in heaven. You may not believe that also. And he was saying, and he was giving a description of the place that he was preparing. He said, "This place that I'm preparing," he said, "my father's house, mansions, many mansions." And you know what a mansion is. Different floors. In other words, he was telling about, do you believe this? He said, "In my father's house, there are many mansions." He said, "I am going to prepare that place. And if I go and prepare that place for you, where I am, there you may be also." Who he was speaking to? He was speaking to disciples. People who was willing to believe what he said. People who was willing to obey his word. People who was willing to do exactly what he said. This promises was not just for anybody. This promise is for those who believe. That is how important belief is. I was talking to somebody, was saying, we could believe in our mind. We could believe with our emotions. I've seen people, when they're in services, cry, "Oh God." I've seen people in services cry, they cry, "Oh God, oh God, oh God," and after that, whoosh, that's it. They believe, but they believe, but it is just an emotional thing. Some people believe, they hear the word, and they put it in their mind and they think about it and they say, yes, it had to be true. And they think and they begin to get fearful and they get frightened every time they see somebody die. But after a while, that leaves them. They believe, but they just think about that. But then there are those that believe and they implement it. They put it into practice. We call that hard belief. I believe that God would say the wages of sin is death and the gift of God is eternal life. And because you want life, you will make some movements and you will turn around and you will make some decisions because you believe in life and you believe what God say. So when Jesus gave the disciples a promise, I am going to prepare a place, everybody wouldn't believe it. Everybody would not accept it. But it's those who choose to believe it. The place that I'm going to prepare is better than this place that you are in. So in Revelation say, we're going to walk on street of gold. What? You believe that? He's going to give us a name. A new name. You believe that? He's going to put a new sound in our mouth. You believe that? He's going to wipe away all tears. You believe that? No more weeping, no more sorrow, no more pain, no more death. He's going to give you another body. And that body that he's going to give you is a body that's not going to be subject to death. You believe that? Who do we believe? What are the things that we believe? What it is that could turn a man's heart away from what God says? What it is that could make a man choose to believe in other words and other things and other person and other promises rather than believing with what God said? How it is we reach that point where God will just play down easy like that? No more that people respect God's word, but it's just like what God said, it really matters again. After a while, a lot of things take place. And we give heed to things. We give heed to people. We give heed to emotions. We give heed to desires. And after a while, we played on God. What you say? I don't care about that. What you say? I don't believe that. And that is what my concern is now. Who do we believe? Who report do we believe? What it is that has have us going and just doing everything beside what God say? Testing everything, but beside what God say. We taking a little bit of taste in everything. I want to test that. I want to taste that. This one bring out this. This one bring out that. It have a new drink on the thing. It have a new thing on the thing. I want to taste that. But what about what God say? Serve your creator in the days of your youth, that when the evil days come, you wouldn't have to run to contrary spirit and ask them, who is God? Where is God? Who believe that? Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God. Keep his commandments. Because this is the whole duty of man. Who believe that? We are afraid of a lot of things. We do afraid God. We're not afraid of God. We afraid police. We afraid sickness. We afraid bandit. We afraid all kind of things, but we just don't respect God. Who do we believe? I'm going to prepare a place for you because I know where you are. This place, in what did the Apostle Paul say, listen, man, this present life that I'm living, he said, I have a desire to leave this and to go with God. Because to live is Christ and to die is gain. Oh God. You don't know what it means to leave this life and to go towards gain. Which means I'm going to invest in not just this life, but I'm going to invest in the life that God promised. What you're investing in now? Clico, go soon fail. We're investing our time in. All these things that we invest in our time in, sometimes at the end of the day, the Bible says, These things are just temporal. So he spoke to the church in Colossae and he said, set your affections on things above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand side of God. What it is about Christ up there that we should set our affections, our passion, we should have a desire to set our eyes on things above. Because there are some things on the earth, Lord, it's deceiving. You run it down after a while, it doesn't have what it tell you. You tell yourself it have. You run down certain things. And for years you keep going at it. And it just not satisfying. After the end of the day, you say, no, you mean this, I spend all my years behind this? We're talking about. You spend all your life to build a house. And after a while, you can't see your old house because the mosquito and heat these days, you have to come out of the house. But you spend your whole life behind this house. But you can't enjoy it after a while. After a while, the bed and all, like, it already makes sense. You spend your whole life going after a car. After a while, the car, how long you stay in the car? You reach on the road, you can't go on the road because traffic. You can't enjoy the thing you buy. The clothes, how long it will take you to enjoy your clothes? Because these things was not meant to last forever. That's the reason why Jesus brought on the scene. He said, listen, I am going to prepare. I want to do some preparation. I know what it's like to prepare. I know what it's like to put things in place. I want to put some things in place. I want to let you know that life is more than life. Life without Jesus is no life. How you know that? I was there. I drink, I smoke, I go on party, I lime, and after a while, I realize, but these things really have nothing much in it, boy. So the enemy tried to distract you. And God tell me to tell somebody something this evening. There are some people that has come into your life. That is assigned by the devil to take you down to hell. There are some people that is assigned down. They may not know the agenda because the enemy does use anybody. They may not know the agenda, but sometimes these things and these people who associate with them show you off course. Get you distracted. You're not on the wrong road. You're not smoking the wrong thing. You're not drinking the wrong thing. Because the wrong, you get yourself in the wrong. The Bible says that there was a young man, the Bible says, who went down from Jerusalem into Jericho. The Bible says that he fell among thieves. We think he just, that's the person who was just taking life just like that. He just get up that morning and he feel to go down in Jericho. But you're supposed to know what Jericho have. Jericho is a cursed city. Jericho and bandit. What the bandits do? They just strip you. They just beat you. And then leave you for half dead. That is what the enemy does. He just beat you. Wound you. Leave you for half dead. Because you're just taking life. Just like that. I feel to do this. And I feel to drink this. And I feel to smoke this, and I feel to eat this. Everything is about your feeling. So this young man just decided that morning he's going to feel to. Thanks be to God. When he reached down in Jericho, they strip him. The world will strip you, young people, if you don't really understand what's going on. The devil will strip you. What he want to strip you of your clothing? Because sometimes according to how you're dressed, it's going to identify who you are. Some of you dressed in purple. Because you have royalty blood in you. You just identify, listen, the Old Testament, you just identify somebody by colors. And God has put you in a color. Because you want the devil to know the potential and who you are. And there are some people come to throw you off course. The only reason why they come in your life is to throw you off course. Do you believe that? Not everybody that survive when they leave you for dead. May the enemy done with you in this life. Sometimes you don't have the strength to build yourself again. Our friends, choose not to live for God. People who are no forsake God, give up God, don't want God. And at the end of the day, it's a sad thing when you have to go back home. You left home, but you see when you're going back home, I'm going to say this and stop. Sometimes you leave home as a wayward child. You leave in the morning, you play morning, 12 o'clock evening. You play all them time, whole day you play, you bathe in the river, you catch fish, you cook, you do all kind of thing. And you study nothing because your friends them keeping you up. Oh God, you're laughing. Oh God, everything going good. Oh boy, but then there comes the hour that you have to go back home, boy. Now you start to study. Lord, boy, while your friend them going back home, they may not get licks. But you know who you had to talk to, who you had to face. Some of you know that when you go back, you had to talk to God. Some of you know, in spite, you may not be doing it, but you know you have somebody to talk to. You have to answer to somebody. Where you was, what you do, all this time you was on the earth, what you did. Did you please me? Did you serve me? Did you worship me? Who you went in your spirit and look for? Who you clothe? Who you feed? What did you do? Was it not about I? Do you believe these things? Do you believe that you're going to be held accountable for your actions on the earth? Do you believe that we'll stand before the judgment seat of Christ? Whether you believe it or not, you can't change it. And one day, the sky is going to peel back. It will happen so quick. This is one of the things that I was amazed in the Bible. That's what the Bible says in Thessalonians. In the moment, in the twinkling of an eye. Oh, look how quick things have changed. You had time to pray, you had time to say, have mercy. Just wink your eye and see how quick it is. The Bible says in the moment, just a moment that things will change. Just as you twinkle your eye, in the moment of the twinkling of an eye, things change. The whole world will be in chaos. You can imagine somebody driving a plane and that person just taking a plane, nobody to steer the plane. Somebody driving, taking away nobody to drive the car. The Bible said two going to be in the field, one taking the other left. Two going to be on the house top, one taking the other left. You know what kind of time is that? At the church time, when God decided to rapture the church, that's what we're looking forward for. What is going to happen after that? When all that chaos in the world, what's going to happen after? We need that. That is where the world is going to be crying. They want a leader now to bring back peace into the world. And they're going to get a leader. A leader that's for 3.5 years is going to give them peace. Things are going to come back in line. People are going to be comfortable again because this leader for 3.5 years will get things back in line. But for the next 3.5 years, you're going to be hell on the earth. Do you believe this? Well, whether you believe it or not, my God's still gone to prepare a place for you and I. And if you believe it, when you believe, you know what belief cause? Belief cause that change my mind. I will change my direction. I'll change my lifestyle. I'll follow God. I'll do God what God pleased with. Godly sorrow. I start to hate the things I used to love, and start to love the things I used to hate. I start to serve God now because I understand that what God say, that is what I'm going to believe. God bless you.
Yeah.
maybe, no might be, no doubt about it. There is a heaven and there is a hell. And there is a choice that every one of us need to make. After Moses and Joshua took over leading the children of Israel, after they had crossed the Jordan River and they reached on the other side, it was then Joshua said to them, "Choose ye this day whom thou wilt serve." But he made his decision before them all and put them in the spotlight to give them the encouragement to make a pertinent choice. And he said after, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." Hear this. We can accomplish more with God in one day than a lifetime without him. Can I say that again? We can accomplish more with God, Reverend Brayton, in one day than a lifetime without him. And that's why Jesus said, "What shall it profit a man that he gain the entire world and suffer the loss? Or what then can a man give in exchange, my friends, for his soul?" God loves us in spite of who we are. In spite of all the blunders that we may have made, my friends, in life. Are you hearing me? I know what it is to make blunders. But I know what it is to trust God to forgive me, to cleanse me and start me out afresh. Are you hearing me? Sometimes, my friends, we might be fearful to make certain decisions in our lives because we're studying what my friends and them will say. But when we stand before God on that final morning, it won't be then what friends had to say, but what choice did we make before in life? It's once we are passing here. Let us use the calling away of our beloved sister as a stepping stone to prepare ourselves likewise. Did you hear me this afternoon? Let us use the calling away of our sister as a stepping stone to prepare ourselves. You know, I remember when I was baptizing, we had a week of revival services. And one of the pastors that came by to minister to us during the course of the week, they sang that song in our hymnal, "Come We That Love the Lord." And there's a part in that hymn that says, "Religion never was designed to make our pleasures less." And the pastor criticized that hymn. He said we should never sing that. But you know, years after, when he came to a fuller understanding of it, oh, he loved that hymn. But really and truthfully, religion never was designed to make our pleasures less. I know what it was, to enjoy some pleasures in the world. But since I'm serving Jesus, I have no regret. There's a little song that says, "I stumbled and fell. He's never failed me yet. I did what I did. He's never failed me yet. Jesus, he never failed me yet." One day, my friends, in a low turn, one day, we all would have to leave the niceties behind. Pastor Brayton was telling us that. We build a nice home, we paint it up. Oh, it's next to no other home in the community. But one day we will spend the last night in the home. Are you hearing me? The car that we have, one day we will drive the car for the last. One out of two things may happen. Either we could get rid of the car. Are you hearing me? Either we get rid of the car or we have to leave the car behind. One day, my friends, I will sing my last song here. Are you hearing me? One day I'll pray my last prayer. Either it's by my bedside, lying on my bed, or somewhere about. One day, my friends, I will preach my last sermon. But I know that I know that I know that God has gone to prepare a place. And my friends, I would encourage every one of us to choose Christ. Because Christ is life.
He said, I am come that you would have life and that you would have it more abundantly. The devil, Pastor Brayton told us, came to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But I am come that you would have life and that you would have it more abundantly. What he does quickly, my friend, he steals, my friend, our joy in life. Are you hearing me? He steals, my friends. Oh, hallelujah. He steals our happiness. There are a lot of people, my friends, they are just sad. We call them, should I use a word on the altar? We call them haters sometimes. Are you hearing me? They're sad. Don't tell them morning on the street. Sometimes they see the face they put up. They won't respond to say good morning. They have issues they're dealing with. They have things that they are going through in life. And they're looking for solutions. But I'm afraid, my friend, sometimes we spend the majority of our time like the woman, my friends, who had the issue of blood, looking for answers. But we are looking, my friend, in the wrong place. But when that woman heard about Jesus, she said, I will try him. Are you hearing me this evening? And hear what? She didn't want a big... She said, if I can only but touch... She didn't want to hold his hand, but she only wanted to touch the hem of his garment. And you know what? As we close today, you can touch Jesus this evening. You can touch Jesus, as Pastor Brayton started, by believing, my friends, in him. You could touch Jesus, my friend, by making a decision to him right now and saying, all to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily live. You can touch Jesus this evening by your love. There's a song that we sing. In moments like these, I'll sing out a song. I'll sing out a love song to Jesus. Tell Jesus how much you love him. Tell Jesus how much you appreciate him. Tell Jesus you realize that you're heading the wrong direction and you want to make a change. But you can't do it on your own. Trust him. He's able to make the difference in your life. Our sister, our friend, our neighbor, our relative lived, but she had to leave. And the final thought with us today, live with leaving in mind. Did you hear me this evening? Live with leaving in mind, because we can be summoned to leave at any time. Our closing hymn this evening, if you have theology and you're still going to share it. All right. What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and grief to bear. What a privilege to carry every day to God in
was born on the 31st of January, 1989. Daughter of Herbert and deceased Eleonora, better known as Dolly. Sister of Andy, Allison, Avalon, Burns, Roger, and Randy, both deceased. She was the aunt of Tristan, Tishon, Jaden, Adriel, and Adriel. She attended the Indian War Government Primary School after moving on to a vocational center. She had a love for hairdressing that soon faded away, and she fell in love with construction. She loved that trade with a passion. Her little figure didn't stop her from toting gravel, mortar, and blocks. Me and Hannah both tried it with her, but we wasn't able. That wasn't for us. Although she was diagnosed with sickle cell, that didn't stop her from living a full normal life. She was a well-loved person everywhere she went. Everywhere she went, she made friends. She was tiny in person, but her voice made up for it. She loved children. She babysat for everyone. So the Wednesday before she passed, me, she and Hannah was rhyming. So we was having a conversation. So we was telling her, Jill, so when you gonna make a little child? She turned and she watched me. She said, what at all come out from all y'all? So we said, Jill, we trying getting big. When you do make this child, who going to play with your child? She saying, I'm not going to make, I shouldn't going to make no children, because when she not make she children, when we go out to Lyme, who going to see them to see body child? So we was like, all right, Jill, no problem. Jill, if we said a talk about Jill today, we are going to finish. We have plenty, plenty memories of Jill. We are going to stop. So all I have to say, Mama, rest up with the angel until we meet again.
Thank you very much. We wanted to say something. All right, the mic on the other side.
Special good afternoon to everyone in the summer region. When I came to live in Fort George, the disease was one of the person that I would interact with, she and her friends. She is a very friendly person. I remember when I came here, she had a twisted ankle. So I saw her limping and things. I said, but what's going on with you, baby girl? She said, well, she twisted the ankle. I got a Chinese meds for her. After a while, she started walking normally. She was a very humble person. You know, regardless of how humble you are, and what I admire about the people in Fort George, I remember a night, my partner was going to drop me in Fort George. A man in the car. Why don't go in there to rob? I say, friend, they're robbing people all about it. So why are you giving Fort George a bad name? You understand? I cannot say nothing about the people in Fort George. The littlest one on the street so would meet me. Mr. Butch, Uncle Butch, you understand? The deceased was a very humble. She was a very friendly person. And her friends around her, I cannot say nothing about them. They're very respectful and all of that. You understand? So, but you see, at this stage, people have been so astonished to say, stand up so the mic and say something. You understand? But where she is, she gone to the better place. She here between us, you know. You know, but a lot of people don't understand that. She going to look, prepare a place for her friends and her family. You understand? So, you know, rest yourself, baby.
Thank you very much, Brother Butcher. Okay, so just before we do the final song, we have with us Miss Marsha Smith. Let me invite you to share with us this evening in song on behalf of the family. Are you here? Oh, thank you so much.
Good afternoon to everyone. I want to say good afternoon to the ministers and all that is present, to the family. And I want to thank my colleague Elliott for this opportunity to be here this afternoon. Okay. Hallelujah. Are you hearing me this afternoon? Nathan. Hallelujah. Are you hearing me now? You know, I went through the Bible and I came across a scripture. Psalms 1:1:1. It says, praise the Lord. I will praise the Lord with my whole heart. I went through that yesterday. Then I came across another scripture this morning. It says Psalms 9. I will praise thee, O Lord, with my whole heart again. So I believe the scripture is speaking to us. I want to say condolence to the Elliott family on behalf of Jelissa. So when I read that, I realized that God wants nothing but our whole heart. He don't want a halfway heart. If the heart decide to pump blood halfway, what would happen to us as human beings? We don't know who holds tomorrow.
I don't know about tomorrow. I just live from day to day. I don't borrow from its sunshine, for its skies may turn to gray. I don't worry of the future, for I know what Jesus said, and today I'll walk beside him, for he knows what is ahead. Only he knows many things about tomorrow. I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand. Every step, it's getting brighter as the golden stairs I climb. Every burden's getting lighter. Every cloud is silver lined. There the sun is always shining. There no tear can dim the eye. At the end, in off the rainbow, where the mountains touch the sky, there are so many things about tomorrow. I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand.
I don't know, you don't know about tomorrow. It may bring us poverty, but the one, the only one who feeds the sparrow is the one who is standing by you. He's standing by me. And the part that is my portion may be through the flood of flame, but it spreads and goes before me, and I'm covered in his blood. If you know it, you can sing. Many things about tomorrow, I don't seem, you don't seem to understand, but I know, yes, we know who holds tomorrow.
Laugh a little bit, as though I was climbing a ladder and I was looking for another step, and the song came to an end. But trust me, many things about tomorrow I cannot understand, but because of who holds tomorrow, I can face my tomorrow with courage. I can face my tomorrow with hope. I can face my tomorrow with joy. come what may, my tomorrow is wrapped up, tied up, and tangled up in Jesus. Thank you very much, sister, for that beautiful song. Put our hands up. Okay, so as we've come to the climax of the service now, may I invite us to stand with me. We worship from that beautiful song, When We Walk With The Lord In The Light Of His Word. While we sing in this song, the ushers will accept a free will offering. Laugh a little bit. Maybe it's the first time you came by here. Are you hearing me? So, you don't come by regular. You come by regular. Leave us with a free will offering as we come to the climax of our service today. When we walk with the Lord in the light of His word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His God well, He abides with us still. And when all over trust and obey, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be a parent is but a trust and obey. Not a pardon we bear, not a sorrow we share, but a toil hid a rest. Not a grief, O Lord, not a frown, O growth, but trust and obey, trust and obey. To be happy, rich is us, but a trust and and for the family, and probably he could include you in his prayer this evening as we've come to an end.
Let's pray as we continue to stand. We want to look to God this evening, the passing of our beloved sister, and we believe that there's excitement after this exercise in the judgment. And as we bow our heads and we pray that God is going to envelop the entire bereaved family. And God is really going to give us the understanding that even in the sight of God, as Psalms 116:15 say, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. And we all have been touched in some way or the other that God is not slack concerning you and I. So as we bow our heads and we pray this evening, we pray with that hope that someday there, as I said, there is excitement in when the Lord would come. I even started last night to talk about that. And if we go into the sixth seal, we will understand that, but that will be left for another time. So let's pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you that we are here. Lord, even at this time, as it says, better to be in the house of mourning. Oh God, will we thank you in a special way this evening that you have brought us together because of one who would have tarried with us over these years, Lord, and you would have thought it best to call her back to your glory. Lord, as we would have indicated, we are only dealing with the shell here now, but you have that wonderful life. You have the whole world in your hand, that anointing and that power and that glory that you share. And someday soon, when you come in the clouds, you're going to meet us together and you're going to judge, oh God, with your authority and with your anointing. So even at this time, we bring the bereaved family, especially Father Hobart. We pray that you anoint him afresh. I pray that you touch him in a special way. Hallelujah. That you give him that unction to function this evening. The children, oh God, and we get in a prophetic word that Lisa couldn't be here, but the word came even today that the Holy Ghost, the host of God, encamps around the dwelling of the just, and protection he affords to all who make his name their trust. And we are sending the word even today as the church sent, that the Spirit is saying that we wish her every success. And by the passing of our beloved sister, that is going to be, that separation is going to bring her into that place. So we breathe that word. We send that anointing. We send that power. We send that glory. And even at this time, that you may comfort her in this way. Comfort the family. Say, comfort those who weep and moan. So the tune of joy may return. So Father God, as we give you praise, as we give you honor, as we thank you, Lord, for the passing, because you said this must happen. In the midst of life, we are in debt. But after death, there is the judgment. And Lord, that must be preached, that we must prepare for that judgment. So I pray that your anointing touch every heart this evening to know that someday soon we are going to meet you in the sweet by and by. And not only that, you're going to judge us according to our work shall be. And none can escape, Lord. So we pray that you give us that heart. As a good song say, oh, for that heart to praise my God. A heart from sin set free. A heart that is sprinkled with the blood. That blood that was freely shed for me. I pray, oh God, that you sprinkle your blood amongst us this evening. You wash us in your pure and your precious blood. Because your blood have power. Your blood have anointing. And we pray for that glory this evening may shine in our hearts. And let us look to you, the author and the finisher of every faith. May God bless you in Jesus' name. And now, may the saving grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, the God, in Jesus' name.
All right, so at this time, as we close, we'll have the casket open. Those who would like to pay their last view to the remains of our sister, feel free to come, and then we proceed on the outside. So we give a few minutes for viewing at this time.
Thank you.